Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus, you will be amazed, astonished, astounded, and entertained. From the opening spectacle in unison with some acts performing in the side rings, an air of excitement and a nostalgic feel of vaudeville will begin to cover the arena. One man who has more acts in the show is Elvin Bell, a daredevil first seen on the Wheel of Death, a gigantic metal structure on which Bell balances himself. Bell has two other acts. He rides a mechanical monster and a meteor cycle. All are handled well. They're fresh, unusual, and appear to be big winners with the audience. The crowd will also enjoy the Flying Vesquez and the Flying Caseras, with the latter being a relatively new act. To watch these flyers is poetry in motion. Many hours of rehearsal go into perfecting these perilous feats of perpetual motion.
Two, one, fire!
An expert in getting someplace fast is Captain Christopher Adams. He's shot out of a rocket. Adams is personable and always on target. All the animal acts are fun and at times dangerous. Charlie Bauman handles the Bad Bengals as if they're house cats, something he's been doing successfully for over 25 years. And on a bigger scale, Axel Gaudier manages the massive pachyderms very well. It's amazing what he can get these heavyweight performers to do. And who says cowboys are the only ones who know how to ride horses? The Slavovi family can put that idea to rest. They're from Bulgaria. A segment that adds spice and pacing to the show is their galloping and delightful horse act. One of the highlights of this year's show is the King Charles Troupe. They very proudly acknowledge themselves as the first all-black circus act ever. Their bombastic basketball and unusual unicycling is fast-paced. It's a comedy performance you won't want to miss. And of course, who can forget the clowns? There are a lot of routines, some are old and some are new. But none of them is without fun, frolic, and laughter. The Merry Masters of Mirth are definitely worth seeing. There are many more acts in the show and all are entertaining. For the young and old, the entire family, I can't recommend a show any better than this 112th edition of the Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus. I'm Dino Lawler. The dancing showgirls are one of the most attractive parts of the circus. They're all beautiful and glamorous, and a lot of hard work goes into their performance. But Janet Matson enjoys her current job as a showgirl much more than her former occupation.
I started out as a school teacher, a high school teacher for English and physical education. I did that for a while and practically burnt out. I didn't actually think about joining the circus. It just sort of came. It was something that, an opportunity that presented itself, and I decided to go ahead and try.
Well, she tried and made it. Janet truly does love her work. She says every day is different. Every day is a blast. Here they are, the Merry Masters of Mirth. The old saying that all the world loves a clown is true, all right, and no one knows it better than Ernest Kitson, a man who spreads joy and laughter to all those around him. His former occupation, a policeman in Lansing, Michigan.
It's an outlet. I get to see people laugh, and in doing so, I'm having a good time doing it. So it's really something special for me. Get out there and just, you're a whole different person in makeup. And just like, you go for it. Just leap into it wholeheartedly and just make people laugh.
And making people laugh is what Ernie enjoys the most. To him, life should not be stilted, but an easygoing stroll, a ride on which we can learn and laugh. Dino Lawley, Action 4.
I have
had so much fun here being around the circus. All the wonderful animals, all the different acts. It must be a blast to work in show business. I wish I could be a part of all this. The beautiful costumes, the great-looking girls. Look at that one. Hello there, Mama. All the funny clowns, the excitement, the glamour, and the girls. Oh, yes, the girls.
I have got to join the circus.
Who's in charge here?
Just a minute, hold on. I'll be with you in a minute. Have a seat. Okay. Yeah, I expect it to be real good, real good. Okay. All right, we'll see you next week. Bye, take care. What can I do for you?
I want to be in the circus.
You want to be in the circus?
Yeah.
What do you do now?
I work in television.
Like I said, what do you do now?
I do movie reviews and entertainment reporting and things of that nature.
What do you think you could do with our show?
Well, I tell you, I know that I can't start at the top and be the star. I'm willing to take a lesser job and maybe move up quickly.
Well, you know, at the circus, everybody starts at the bottom. Even I started at the bottom.
I can tell.
I'm sure I can find something that you could handle that would match what you've been doing in television?
Right,
television.
Right.
I'll fix you up.
Hey, hurry up! We have 5 minutes!
Okay, here.
Excuse me, my name is Dino Lally. I just got hired today and it's first day on the job.
Oh, lucky man, lucky man.
They tell me that I have a uniform that I can wear in my position.
Yeah, you got uniforms.
Oh, okay.
You want one?
Yeah, I need one. That's what they told me.
There you go.
So what do you have this
night? Mr. Gold. It's me again, the guy from downstairs. The first job that you gave me was not exactly what I had in mind. I'd like to be out in the public more, you know?
You want to get closer to the public?
I want to get closer to the public. That's right. You got it.
Well, here. Try this on.
Cotton candy here. We've got light and cotton candy. Excuse me.
Go somewhere. This is my territory.
Well, I'm new, and they told me to come
over here. Well, tough. You go over there.
Okay, I'll go over here.
Hey, man, which way are you going?
Well, they told me to come over here.
He just got in town last night.
I'll go over there, too.
In town, see?
I've been in here since 73. You going to tell me something?
Okay, go over there.
I tell you what. Okay, well, they just told me to come over here.
Well, he told you wrong, man.
Well, they told me to go over here, though.
You better go hit the street.
I tell you, I'll go hit the streets.
Well, you better hit the streets. It doesn't mean anything to you.
I'll see you after the show.
Oh, okay. Candy!
Real good and last show. I really enjoyed it. Thanks a lot.
Mr. Gold.
Yeah, what do you want now?
The other two jobs that you had me doing, they're not what I had in mind. You know what I'm talking about? I want to be close to the performers. I want to be able to help them in some way.
Well, you know, I think I have the right job for you.
Oh,
what do you
no.
think?
You're not going to make them.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
I think we'll do it.
Great.
Hey, thanks a lot. I wish there was some way that we could let the people here in Oklahoma City know that we really depend on you to keep the show running smoothly.
No problem.
What's your name again?
Dino.
Right, stick with
That's
me,
right.
kid. We'll make you star.
Okay.
Have you seen the cat?
I just want to be in the circuit.
It's a strange feeling to be in here right now. The performers are gone. The audience is gone. The three rings are empty. I've had the opportunity to be around the circus the last couple of days, and it was quite an experience. And although I didn't actually get to perform, I had a lot of fun. To put a show on like this takes a tremendous amount of work, and I have decided the best place to see the circus is right here in the stands. And I hope you have that opportunity while the show is in town. I'm Dino Lawley, Action 4 with Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus in Baltimore. And although I didn't actually get to perform, I had a lot of fun. To put a show on like this takes a tremendous amount of work, and I have decided the best place to see the circus is right here in the stands. And I hope you have that opportunity while the show is in town. I'm Dino Lawley, Action 4 with Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus in Baltimore.
As the battery fades into the sunset.
Animals. Without them, the Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus just wouldn't be the same. The animals are an essential part of the show. How many mammals altogether? Nearly 350 animals are cared for between the two different touring units of the circus. To take care of all the circus animals is a tremendous job. It takes 150 people to look after and feed them. A weekly menu for the animal department reads like this. 10 tons of hay, 5,600 pounds of sweet feed, 1,000 pounds of bran, 75 pounds of whole wheat and white bread, 3 cases of lettuce, 20 dozen eggs, 20 gallons of milk, and it goes on and on. A diet for Weight Watchers this isn't. The animal most associated with the circus is the elephant, and the man who knows the precarious pachyderm best is the famous elephant trainer, Axel Godier. Axel, how long have you been working with elephants?
About 23 years.
How did you get started?
My family was in the circus business.
And you just...
Well, they were actually horse trainers. And, how I got started with elephants, that was the last thing I ever started with. You can start them quite young, 6 months even. But a good time is about a year. And then if you have the time to work with it every day, well, in a year's time, you should have it pretty well to go into an act.
What's the average age where they tend not to perform very well?
Usually, about 50 years you can keep an elephant in a circus.
Axel pointed out when it comes to personality, elephants are like people. Everyone is different. And we found out that applies not only to the elephants, but to all the animals. If you're around them enough, they all seem to take on human characteristics. It's as if you can hear them talking, especially at lunchtime.
Well, what are you TV guys doing here anyway? You're turning this place into a real circus.
6 years and stir, I'm going crazy in here. They don't let me out soon and feed me, I'm gonna get even. I'm gonna eat the trainer tonight.
Hey, you mustache, come here.
I'm gonna put that camera down, I want some oats.
Hey, we don't want to gas you.
Say, you put that camera down, put some oats in this hell bucket.
Get some oats.
Don't let me have to get up. You ain't gonna bite nothing, son. Nah, you ain't gonna, ow, don't bite me in the oats, son.
Well, you know, it doesn't look very much like a fire hydrant, but I guess it will do.
Oh, hold on there, son. What you think you be doing sniffing up my leg like that? What's the deal here?
Say, listen, I thought you were an oak tree or something, you know? I don't know.
Ain't no tree, and you come back here when I'm talking to you. I ain't through with you yet. How'd you like to be a hairy ink spot, you hairy mongrel?
Oh, let me go, you big dummy. I guess I'm in the doghouse now.
In every town, the elephants are taken out to eat. In this case, it's downtown Baltimore with yours truly leading the way.
Can I rent a parachute? Is it possible?
If there's one thing elephants enjoy more than performing, it's eating. It's not all meat and potatoes for the elephants, or lettuce and potatoes in this instance, but they're not complaining, and Axel isn't either. He loves his work, and he's very good at it. Besides, who else can say his employees are glad to work for peanuts? Dino Lolly, Action 4.
I felt at first it might be a mistake to try to remake any film. But then on thinking about it, what a challenge.
You're saying that that thing in the ice was trying to become our dogs?
Yeah. Seems to be able to imitate other life forms.
So what's our problem?
Thing's not dead yet.
In this particular story, 12 guys begin to mistrust and distrust and be so leery of each other that they're barely able to function.
This version is quite different than the Hawks version. The biggest change in the film is the nature of the monster. It's really impossible to photograph it because it's never any one thing at any one time. It's constantly changing, so it has no original form.
To me, what's fascinating about the idea of who goes there and John Carpenter's the thing is the idea that what we have to deal with is so bizarre, and yet it's no more bizarre than what the thing has to deal with. We're as bizarre to it as it is to us.
Hollywood movie studios love a remake. They were doing them long before Frankenstein became Young Frankenstein. Now director John Carpenter has brought to life the 1951 Howard Hawks science fiction classic, The Thing. Carpenter calls the picture less a remake than a refashioning.
I felt at first it might be a mistake to try to remake any film. But then on thinking about it, what a challenge.
The Thing was adapted from the 1938 pulp story Who Goes There, written by John Campbell, one of the deans of science fiction. It concerns an isolated group of research scientists at the South Pole. They battle a murderous creature from another planet with the power to change its form and possess its victim's mind and body. Actor Kurt Russell.
The thing's not dead yet.
In this particular story, 12 guys begin to mistrust and distrust and be so leery of each other that they're barely able to function.
This version is quite different than the Hawks version. The biggest change in the film is the nature of the monster.
In the 1951 version of The Thing, the monster looks like a man, but is composed of vegetable matter. It's been criticized for being unsophisticated and called an intellectual carrot. Not so with the Carpenter version, which makes a gruesome metamorphosis from body to body.
It's really impossible to photograph it, because it's never any one thing at any one time. It's constantly changing, so it has no original form.
In keeping with the imagination of the times, Hawk's monster meets its end by being electrocuted. Carpenter's adaptation comes closer to the original story, but with a more volatile and startling climax.
To me, what's fascinating about the idea of Who Goes There and John Carpenter's The Thing is the idea that what we have to deal with is so bizarre, and yet it's no more bizarre than what the thing has to deal with. We're as bizarre to it as it is to us.
I'm Dino Lolly. More than ever before, movie makers are going on location to add realism to their films. The setting for John Carpenter's new movie, The Thing, is the ultimate desert, Antarctica. To simulate those severe conditions, Carpenter chose Stewart, British Columbia, and the Taku Glacier in Juneau, Alaska.
We picked Alaska primarily for its look, and secondly, because we could get access to the ice fields and the glaciers and build our sets out there.
A principal movie set is the American Research Station, which was constructed near the former gold rush town of Stewart, British Columbia. Every hotel room in the remote community of 1500 was booked, and crews worked for weeks in temperatures near 30 degrees below zero.
We had a lot of problems in filming. It was cold. We had to fly in by helicopter every day to do our shots and then fly back out. A limited amount of daylight because we were shooting in November and December. We had lenses that would freeze up on us.
Yeah, number one.
Star of the movie, Kurt Russell, used to the palmier climbs of Southern California, enjoyed working in Canada.
It was pretty rugged. I mean, it was pretty interesting. It was like being on the moon, kind of, you know. It was nothing but whiteness around you.
Despite the heavy snowfall, Hollywood was not to be outdone by nature. Large fans blew in artificial snow to beef up the blizzard scenes. Interior locations were filmed on frozen downstages in the middle of a torrid Los Angeles summer.
It was about 108 degrees, and we were shooting on sets that were 20 degrees and wearing heavy parkas and things. And so when you go outside, it was difficult not to catch colds and get sick.
If shooting on location adds important elements of realism, Carpenter admits it also brings its own share of difficulties.
I'm dealing with shooting in very rough conditions in the snow, which is always very difficult. Dealing with big effect scenes, big chase scenes, big explosions. It's just very complex.
I'm Dino Lolly.
The phrase masters of the macabre used to apply to writers of science fiction and horror stories. Today's wizards of wonder are movie makeup special effects artists. Films like An American Werewolf in London, The Howling, and John Carpenter's new film, The Thing, would be impossible without them.
We actually perform a magic trick, if you will, on stage in front of a camera. So it looks totally believable. In other words, there's no way that we haven't fooled the audience because it looks so good.
For The Thing, director John Carpenter wanted the monster to be completely different from the creature in the original 1951 film. Enter Rob Bottin, 23-year-old special effects wizard.
And I would just say a joke out of black humor, like, you know, the guy's stomach rips open and turns into a big mouth, you know, and he bites this guy's arms off. And John would start laughing, and he'd go, you know, that's not a bad idea.
Makeup special effects artists are a new breed. Besides designing what things will look like, they employ mechanical devices which transform the ordinary into the extraordinary. To make The Thing believable, Bottin needed appropriate stand-ins for real actors.
You go ahead and make a puppet that looks exactly like the person, and then putting mechanical effects inside to go ahead and move, you know, the puppet. We'll use hydraulics, we'll use pneumatics, we even ran one of the puppets off of a computer. The monster is constantly, you know, dripping goo, you know, and all this stuff and that. Sometimes we use mayonnaise or cream corn, eggs for eyeballs, you know. It all looks good because it's real.
For a man capable of producing such horrifying effects, Bottin admits a real monster would scare the life out of him.
Some of the ideas and stuff, I guess, are just from having a very big imagination. You know, I'm always daydreaming about things. And also, I was afraid of the dark when I was a kid. You know, so I was always wondering, you know, what would be under the bed.
I'm Dino Lolly. Actor Kurt Russell was 10 years old in 1961 when he began acting in numerous television series. Within a short time, he established himself as one of Hollywood's most sought-after teenage actors, eventually settling on a long-term contract with Walt Disney Studios. Russell virtually grew up on the Disney lot, starring in 9 films over a 10-year period.
I just found that I enjoyed working on the set more than I did being in public school. I never did like public school, and my folks always felt that I progressed a lot more in many, many ways as a human being and as a student.
It was Russell's portrayal of Elvis Presley in the 1979 television movie Elvis that made the critics finally stand up and take notice.
It was difficult to separate the picture from the character because the character was the picture. It didn't make any difference really what went on there except that Elvis was there and then you did Elvis. If you did that well, then the show went well.
Elvis was Russell's first experience working with director John Carpenter.
I think Kurt Russell is a great actor. He's one of the few actors that I've met that I felt that he can really play anything.
Indeed, the Elvis movie opened new doors for Russell, including a shot at comedy. He received rave reviews for his comedic efforts in Used Cars. And teaming up again with John Carpenter, he starred in the science fiction thriller Escape from New York.
I just loved playing a character who was totally one-dimensional. And I love that kind of movie. Only can you do that in the movies, and only can you be like that in the movies.
Russell plays a similar character in The Thing, his latest movie with Carpenter, a refashioning of the 1951 classic horror film.
When I'm scared by something, it's because I don't know what it is and I'm confused by it. I think that when I was playing the part of MacReady in The Thing, that's basically what I was looking at, was the amazement of it.
At 31, having achieved new success and new recognition, Kurt Russell reflects on his 21 years in show business.
All I could ever say about it was I would wish for everybody to have the kind of life that I've had. I just can't complain.
I'm Dino Lally.
What Steven Spielberg's E.T. does for love, amazement, and charm, John Carpenter's The Thing provides us with despair, blood, gore, and yuck. This film is a remake of the 1951 Howard Hawks classic. The movie's monster was played by young actor James Arness. In this remake, John Carpenter and writer Bill Lancaster, he's Bert's son, they follow the original 1938 science fiction story more closely. In that tale, the monster, or thing, is chameleon-like. It devours the victim and assumes its image. So therefore, it's hard to tell who or where the thing is at until it decides to show itself like this. Yeah, that's the worst case of indigestion I've ever seen. A group of American scientists are terrorized by this hideous monster. It landed on Earth over 100,000 years ago. It's frozen in Antarctica and eventually rediscovered by some Norwegians. Kurt Russell and companion come upon a deserted camp and discover the horror that will soon affect them and their camp.
Some animal buried in the ice and they chopped it up. But where is it? Look at this. What is that? Is that a man in there or something?
The film starts out very well. The suspense and mystery are there. The photography is beautiful. But after the first 20 minutes or so, it's downhill along with the blood and gore. So much so that the gruesome effects, which are good, take away from the flow of the entire picture. It's difficult to keep up with all 12 men. Carpenter was obviously trying to transmit a story on paranoia, because in the picture you certainly can't trust anyone, but he doesn't completely accomplish this feat. The acting is pretty decent. Russell and the rest of the crew are convincing in their role. Now, technically, the film is excellent and the musical score is enhancing. But there's a negative energy in the film. That plus the slow pacing and the blood and the gore, the thing is somewhat of a disappointing and empty movie. And Jerry, it's not pronounced the thang, but the thing. There's one big thing wrong with this picture, and that's the film never gets off the ground until Clint Eastwood does. The movie almost runs out of fuel, as a matter of fact, before the action starts. Clint Eastwood produced, directed, and stars in this semi-suspenseful espionage story. He is Mitchell Gann, a retired military pilot. Gann is recruited by American and British intelligence agencies to steal a Russian warplane. In Russia, of course. Now, this is no ordinary flying machine. This futuristic superplane, codenamed Firefox, is years ahead of anything we've got. It can fly five times the speed of sound. It has a thought-controlled weapon system, and the aircraft is invisible to radar. The problem in the film, though, is the action gets bogged down in too much dialogue. The character development is almost nil. The opportunities for some real suspense and mystery are blown along the way. There are a few good, interesting moments, but the audience would like to have seen less talk and more flying. Firefox is approximately 2 hours and 15 minutes long.
Well, that's it. We might as well all go home.
I felt like it at times, that's for sure. We have to wait a long time to see any good flying action. Why couldn't we have seen some sooner?
I don't know.
It's obvious you don't know. When the flying action finally does come, it's a little bit of a letdown. Scenes reminded you of some of the flying sequences from Star Wars, you're not alone. The man who did those special effects for Firefox, John Dykstra, also did them for Star Wars. For Clint Eastwood fans, the film will still fly on its own. For others, I think it will never completely get off the ground. I'm Dino Lawley.
I understand.
Feature The Secret of Nimh is the first feature from Don Bluth Productions. He and 16 others left Walt Disney Studios over 2 years ago. The Secret of Nimh is an action fantasy produced and directed by Don Bluth himself.
It was you.
The story is about a little widowed field mouse who is afraid for the life of her family because the farmer and his tractor and plow are coming into the field. And there's a day called Moving Day where all the animals get the heck out of the field, you know, because it's spring. Well, her youngest son has pneumonia and cannot leave the house, so she can't take him out, and yet the plow's coming into the field. So she's in a dilemma about how to save her children. She encounters a wonderful group of rats who are highly civilized that live underneath the farmer's house, and she is sent to them